Okay, so today's lecture is a bit more about BPMN than we saw last week. So last week we saw the basics of BPMN. Let me have a bit of a refresher on it. We saw that in essence, a BPMN model consists of events, you know, that are things that happen, a message that I receive, or something that happens in the external world, an activity or a task where I do some work, you know, either a person or a person using an information system or a software system independently, and decision points or branching points more generally that are called gateways. And then these three types of elements are connected by solid arrows called flows or sequence flows, which basically denote temporal sequencing. One thing needs to occur or we need to cross something before we get to the other thing. So this is the 4 basic elements of process model. But on top of that, we want to say other things. Like we want to say who performs each activity or who triggers each event. And that can be done using pools and lanes. Remember, pools denote independent organizational entities. Like, for example, two different companies, or a company and their customers, or a company and their suppliers. Whereas lanes is a way of subdividing a company or an organization into roles or departments such that every role is responsible for different activities. We can then draw messages between different pools, for example, to say that an activity sends a message to some external party. Or we can add to every activity or to an activity or to an event in a process, we can add associations to data objects or data stores to denote that a given activity, for example, needs some data from a data object or from a data store, or updates a data object or writes into a data store. And that's pretty much it. That's the basics of BPMN. And then there are a lot of nuances. So we saw, for example, there are three different types of gateways. Exclusive gateways are marked with an X. So there are XOR splits and XOR joints. There are parallel gateways, AND splits and AND joints. And then there are inclusive gateways, OR splits and OR joints. So these are denoted with an X, these ones are denoted with a plus, and these ones are denoted with an O. Right, questions? Yes?
Tell again what are we using associations for?
Very simple. If you want to say that an activity writes into a data object, you will draw an association from the activity to the data object, and you can even put an arrow to say it writes into it, or the arrow in the other direction to say it reads from it, or no arrow. In that case, it means that it both reads and writes. Right. So these lines that connect activities with data objects look like this. They are dashed. As opposed to the solid arrows that connect, that denote sequence flows. Just to say, it's not a sequence flow. It's not like I do an activity and then I put into a data object, etc. In particular, that's a very good question you asked, because this is a very common, I would say, syntactic mistake. I notice in process models that students submit as homeworks is that you have a task A, and then there is either an association or even a sequence flow towards an object, say a PO, and then either an association or a sequence flow, random pick, to another activity B. Right? If you put flows here, well, it's plainly syntactically incorrect in BPMN. But that's not the main point that I want to make. Okay? If you put associations, it's kind of syntactically correct, almost. Except that now we do not know how are A and B related. Right? So you still need to say, are they related like by a simple sequence? Are they related to some gateway in the middle? Is there a loop or a cycle somewhere? So the fact that, the point is, the fact that you add data objects and the UAD associations does not waive the need to also depict your control flow. This in BPMN, the control flow has to be depicted anyway, and the data objects can be overlaid on top of it, but do not replace the control flow. Okay. So, and I can understand that in some cases I can understand the point you want to make. Like if you put me these, I can understand your intuition that you want to say, well, A and B are in a perfect sequence. A creates or writes into a purchase order, and B uses it. Right? So in that particular case, I can understand it. Then the model becomes more complex, and there are points where I cannot understand what exactly you meant by this. Right? More generally, I think it is a very good practice, and let's try to do that, that the process models that you draw are what we call biconnected. And biconnected is very simple. It means that in control flow terms, every task is on a path from a start event to an end event. Right? So, for example, if I delete this, I don't have any more this property. B is not on a path from the start to the end, neither A. Because when I say on a path, I do not count associations, only control, only the sequence flows. Yes? Yeah, associations are only between an activity, a flow object, and an artifact. An association is something that connects a flow object, the ones in the upper left corner, to an artifact, meaning these ones on the lower right corner. Right? Only those ones. To connect two flow objects, you use a flow. And to connect, and the messages are from flow objects, typically activities or events, to pools or to other activities and events. Any other questions? Right, now I have a question. Did you do the quiz of last week? Yes, you did it, isn't it? Great, phenomenal. Can I say that those who maybe didn't need to do it actually did it? So I'm going to do it with you. So this was chapter 3 last week, so let's go for the online quiz, since, you know, that's the only way of making you do the quizzes. If a task has two output arcs, I'm going to draw it for you. There is a task, and it has one, two, this is my task, and there are two outgoing arcs, two other tasks, another task, and yet another task. Then this is the same as if the task was followed by, please correction, followed by which of the following? Is the same as if this was followed by? An end speed. Phenomenal. Phenomenal. I misread the question. It probably was if a task has two. You know what? Is that the question is incorrect. Has two output arcs. It is the same as if it was preceded by. Actually, it's me who made something stupid. I clicked on the wrong button, right? It was just to see if you were awake. We said an end split, so I should have ticked on C, right? It was on C, not on D. Yeah, right. So, sorry, you can take me off a point, right? You know, you can take in your student feedback. You can put, you know, minus one because I missed the right click. Right. Now let's make sure we click on the right one. If a task has two input arcs this time, so this time I have a task that has two inputs. This is my task coming from two other tasks. I don't know. It is the same as if this task was preceded by an XOR join. An XOR join. Make sure I click on the right one. B B B. Op. Yes, yes, I clicked on the right one. Okay, that was just warm up. Which type of gateway is such that it takes a token as input? Every gateway moves tokens around, right? Which type of gateway is such that if there is a token in one of its input arcs, all it does is to immediately move it to that token to an output arc? No, an AND split to one of its input arc. If there is a token here, it moves a token here and here to both of its input arcs. No, so it's not an AND split. So the fact that it has its input, its output arc suggests that there is only one output arc. Okay. And the fact that it says that it receives one token on one of its input arcs suggests that there are possibly many input arcs. So there are many input arcs, and there is one output arc, and it's an XOR, right? We agree, it's an XOR. The XOR is very dumb. It sees something in the input. I mean, someone bites him here, and he bites the next one, right? Okay? I ping you somewhere, anywhere, and you ping the next guy, right? That's an XOR job.
It's okay, but just a question. I'm kind of confused about XOR and OR. What's the difference?
The difference is this one. The XOR, if you ping him here, it just pings the next guy.
Okay.
Okay, let me try again. Beep! Beep!
Okay.
XOR. Now I'm going to do an OR join. Okay. Beep! Anyone is going to beep beep? Nobody beeps me? Okay. Beep! Right? So, when? You have to beat me then. Okay. Beep! Wait, when is going to beat me? Beep, 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 beep! I waited for him to beat me.
Okay.
Right? I wasn't like, somebody beeps me and I beep, no? Somebody beeps me, I look backwards to see if anybody is going to pick me on the other side. If I see nobody will pick me, then I ping the next guy.
Oh.
Not necessarily. I'm going to show you another scenario. I'm an OR join. Beep! There's nobody there, right? You agree with me?
Mm.
Beep! So I didn't wait for the second one.
Okay.
Because I didn't have to. But I checked.
Okay.
So if an XOR join, you do beep on this side, he does beep on that side. If somebody later does beep here, he does beep again twice.
I have a question concerning XOR join and AND joins. You said for an XOR join, you have two multiple input flows.
Yeah.
Right? How do you differentiate that from an AND join?
Ah, this is an XOR join, and this is an AND join. So I differentiate it because this has a plus and this has an X.
No, I'm talking about like the input. Like, for example, the question when it says, what type of join has two input flows and gives up one output?
Yeah, but that was not the question.
I mean,
if somebody had asked me that question, then unsplit would have been a AND join would have been a correct answer. XOR split would have been a correct answer. And OR split would also have been a correct answer. There would have been three correct answers.
Okay, just to confirm that.
Right. A join is defined as something that has multiple inputs and one output, right?
Okay.
Right. So that's what a join is. Now, there are different types of join, and the question actually refers to one explicitly, and it's an XOR. Only the XOR one fits the description. The AND doesn't, because you have to wait for both. And the OR doesn't, because you might have to wait for both. XOR join. XOR join. Beep, beep. Correct! Wow! I got two right. Now, this one, you know it. The following BPM and dialer contains one incorrect gateway. Which one? A, B, C, or D? C, the AND gateway just before F. That one is not right. Huh? Yep! Yeah, I got it. The AND one before. What should it be, that gateway?
Because when we move this last way, this we have last zone. Yeah, we come
if we
back.
Come here, we come back,
and then we can't just exit from the zone.
Yeah, then after E we get stuck. Yeah, when we do the iteration once, we do F, then G, then come back, then do E, then we get stuck. And how do we correct this model? Make it an OR join. So, did you get now the difference between an OR join and an XOR one? We cannot make it an XOR, because if we made an XOR, let's look at the first iteration. A, then parallel B and D. Let me now assume that B goes very quick, so we move to C. C goes very quick, then we move on. We put a token just before the gateway. Let me assume that that gateway is an XOR join, please. For 1 minute, let me assume that that gateway is an XOR join. What will happen then? The token is put forward. Now I do F, right? Then now finally D finishes because D was still going on, right? Then the token moves on to E, then the token moves on to the gateway, and that gateway, let me assume, is an XOR join. What happens now? I move it again. So I do F once more. So I end up doing F twice.
If it is OR join and the activity E takes so long time, does the OR join still need the activity E to finish?
The OR join in the first iteration will do this. I do A, then I do, let's say, B and D. Let me assume that D is very slow. I do B, then C. Mm-hmm. Then I do C, and then I put a token there. Now, let me assume that that gateway is an OR join. Mm-hmm. Then that OR join has been pinned on one side. But then it looks on the other side, and then it sees, C is being executed. And after that, I might get the token. I will probably get the token. So I wait for it.
So it doesn't matter if the activity takes a long time.
I wait for it. It has to be not dependent. He's like, just looking. Looking, looking, looking. For as long as it has to look. No, don't worry. It's a very patient gateway. It will wait as long as you have to wait. I mean, you must be kidding me, but once someone, we had developed some execution engine for business processes, and someone in a company came up with this, he's saying like, well, we really have a problem, because we cannot use your engine, because we put a timer for 1.5 years, and it didn't kick on after 1.5 years. Because there were some problems in the logging that made it that sometimes when the server went down and you restore it, it didn't remember some stuff. And then a timer that had been placed in this process that would take 1.5 years didn't kick in after 1.5 years. And people were not happy. So, yeah, sometimes activities can take a lot of time, like 1.5 years, right? Well, it turns out it was very important that stuff happening after 1.5 years. Okay, this one. I'll make it easier for you. Is it kind of readable? I'll kind of zoom it a little bit. Well, actually, I'll make it simpler for you. The problem is in that visible area. There is a task at the beginning, but there's no problem with it. There are some gateways here that are not right? Which ones? The XOR join or split?
And split XOR join.
Yeah, there is a combination and split XOR join. That's like dynamite, right? Because you start two branches and you're only waiting for one to complete, right? Most likely the XOR join is not right. Correct? Okay, anything else?
There is an unsplit after an XOR,
yeah. Exactly. Just before this task plan meeting second taker, there is this unsplit here that is paired with an XOR split. That's not going to work because this thing is going to behave like an AND join if it has multiple arcs, which means it will be waiting for both things to happen, but only one of them is going to happen, so it will get kind of stuck. Right. So, right, and to fix it, the one before handout cars, that one there, should be what?
An XOR?
It is currently an XOR, the one before handout cars.
And
it should be an AND join, right? So I wait for all three inputs, tokens in all three incoming arcs, and the other one should then be? An XOR join, right? This one should be split into an XOR join to pair it up with the XOR split nicely, followed by an AND join. Not something like I'm going to dribble it here. You should first have an XOR split because you have an XOR split here, so you pair it up, and then you can plug it into this AND join. And put in the third branch, the one that comes from above. Right? Let me see. So the XOR gateway preceding handout cards, that's not right, and the AND gateway preceding plan meeting second intaker, meaning this task here. Correct. The XOR gateway should be an AND gateway, and the AND gateway should be, well, he proposes to make it an OR gateway or put in an XOR join before it and then leave the AND gateway. I think that's more elegant. It really says what it has to say. There is a company, it's an IT hardware shop. It provides a front end that allows customers to purchase equipment, e.g. laptops, accessories, printers, etc., to put in purchase orders, right? In brief. Okay, you know what a purchase order is, right? Otherwise, maybe you missed some course somewhere before this one, right? So in this context, let us assume in this company we have an order to cash process, the process that starts with a purchase order. Which of the following is likely to be modeled as a data store in this process? The customer relationship management system, the CRM, which is the system where we maintain information about our customers. The shopping cart of the customer, so a customer creates an order by picking items in the catalog and adding them to a shopping cart. Right. The history of the customer's past purchases. So the customer previously has purchased things and we use them to maybe do some cross-selling during the order to cash process. An invoice. Or and or the store's product catalog, the catalog of the store. Multiple answers are possible. Which of them can be modeled as a data store? Which one, sorry? The catalog, most definitely, yes. You will read from the catalog. The catalog contains, it's a container. It contains a lot of items. The CRM, yeah. The CRM, you have to retrieve from the CRM information about the customer, billing details, shipping details, credit details, credit card, or other payment details. So, yes, you need to read from there. And somebody mentioned the customer's past purchase orders. Mm-hmm. So that, well, the CRM will contain the customer's past purchase order as a data store, but the customer past purchase orders, just like a customer, is one object. Mm-hmm. It's one fragment of a data store, in this case, the CRM. So I will model that one as a data object. So a data object, if it refers to one entity, a data store if it refers to a container. You remember that difference, containers and items? Yes? Otherwise you can repeat. I would recommend you a course that you can repeat next year to get it right. Okay. A and E. Yeah, correct. The next question, we are not done. Oh my God. Let us consider an order-to-cash process in a company called Coolit, which apparently sells air conditioning systems. Which of the following one is likely to be modeled as a pool? Not the pool in the customer's premise, but a pool in the BPMS sense, right? The customer, a subcontractor of Coolit, a salesperson of Coolit, a clerk at the accounts payable department of Coolit, meaning the department where they pay invoices, or the department responsible for receiving invoices and paying them?
Customer.
The customer is a pool, yeah, because they are external to Coolit, and a subcontractor of Coolit, like for example, to install the cooling system, we are going to send a subcontractor, and we have to send messages to the subcontractor to tell them, go and install this air conditioning system from our warehouse, takes it to the customer premise, install it in this way. Then we're going to send messages to the subcontractor to let them know that they need to do this. So that's a separate pool. And finally, which of the following statements is not true? So this is a way to make you nervous at the exam. So not true. Okay. A, the target of a message flow may be a task, meaning that I can have this, a message flow going into a task, okay? The source of a message flow may be a task. Source means the input, so that this is okay. A message flow can connect a task in a pool to the boundary of another pool. So it's telling you, this statement is telling you that if I have a pool here and a pool here, and I have a task here, for example, I can have this. A message flow can connect a task in a pool to another task in the same pool. That will mean that I have two pools. This is, for example, clerk. And this is salesperson. And there is a task here, a task there, and this one sends a message to that one. And a message flow may lead to the creation of a data object by a task that receives a message. Meaning that it doesn't matter in what context, I can have a task A where I receive a message and then I create, let's say, a purchase order as a result of it. So which one of those statements bothered you?
D.
D, right? Clearly. D. A message flow always has to be between different pools. From one pool to another pool, not within the same pool. I know nowadays there are people sending emails to themselves. Even worse, some people even reply to their own emails. Right? Okay? But in BPMN, you cannot send a message to yourself. And you cannot even less reply to it. Right? A message flow can connect a task in a pool to another task in the same pool. Correct. Phenomenal. So, basics of BPMN is there.
Phenomenal. Let's move on.
Now, talking about things that are wrong in this model, does anyone see something wrong in this model?
It's complicated.
Wow. Wow, that's deep. That's a deep thought. You're right. It is complicated. Right. Right. What about this one? That's better, right? That's much better. What if I tell you that this one is the same one as the previous one? That's really awesome, right? Okay. So I don't need to convince you then that we need to have some processes. I don't need to convince you that I will remove systematically one or two points to whoever submits a homework without some processes. Right? So what did I do here? I basically took part of a process, single entry, single exit preferably, that had to do with one entity. In this case, everything that has to do with raw materials. Yeah? You want to ask a question?
This is probably great, right? I mean, there's an XOR split among them, right?
There is an XOR split, and there is no join, but there are multiple. Oh, yeah, there is. Look, this branch.
No, there is.
Yeah. It's correct. I can do this. If I take this branch, I will do all this and then go back and do the other branch. Nothing wrong about it. If I do this branch, then forget about this one. Right? You only do this branch. If I do this branch, here's the trick. You do all this, and then you move on and you do the other branch. Ah, oh, by the way, there is an XOR join here. Yeah.
Why don't you have a gateway from manufacturer to gateway?
Because I am lazy. But that's we just replied to that question. We all just answered that question. A task that has multiple incoming flows is equivalent to a task preceded by an XOR join. Yeah, so it's actually quite correct, yeah. So let's move on. So what I did is that I took this part of the process that had to do all with raw materials, and I say, okay, there is a phase in the process where I am dealing with raw materials. I am checking if the raw materials are available. If they are not available, I will order them. If I cannot order them, I will figure out what else to do. But I'll get those raw materials. So there is a point in the process that takes me from not knowing if I have the raw materials to having the raw materials in place to produce the order. And then there was another thing that had to do with shipping and invoicing the product, sending the shipment and receiving the invoice. By the way, I could even have split it a little bit finer grained and put in things that have to do with shipping and invoice separately. I just then thought that that would be too many sub-processes, because then, and that there will be sub-processes with only two tasks. And that's common sense. I will not do a sub-process with only two tasks, right? That's plain common sense. So beware. When you use sub-processes, you have to use common sense. Warning, common sense, right? You don't do a sub-process with one task, right? But you are good at using common sense, so that's fine. So a sub-process is, in essence, an activity that I will put into my sub-process, just like this one. I will mark with a plus sign to say that there is an entire sub-process below. So I put this little plus marker below the activity. In essence, if you are using a tool, this means that when you click in here, it will open a separate diagram with the sub-process. Or when you click into here, you open a separate diagram with the sub-process. So it's an activity. It looks like any other activity with this plus marker. that when it is executed, what it does is to invoke another subprocess. That subprocess gets executed from start to end, and when it returns, the activity is considered to have completed and you move on. Very simple. It's like a method call, right? So simple. You will use it for three purposes. The first purpose is the one that we saw. We had a large model, and we wanted to decompose it into smaller models. Right? So that to make it more readable. Anytime you model a realistic process, a real process, you will have to do this decomposition. Almost no real process, except some trivial ones, will look like, lift your finger, punch the guy. Those process models don't get to model them in practice. In practice, you are only interested in modeling a process if it is of a certain complexity, and that will mean that you have a process with, let's say, 30, 50, 100, thousands of tasks. So that exists. There exist process models, end-to-end, thousands of tasks. That's pretty common, in fact. So the process model offers you a mechanism to partition your process into manageable chunks. The second reason why you might want to use subprocesses is if you have repetition in your process model. So you model something and you saw that the same thing is needed here, but also needed there, and maybe somewhere else. So for example, I have part of my process has to deal with obtaining customer details. In different parts of my process, I get to a point where I need to ask the customer to create an account and enter their details in order to proceed. So I will create a sub-process for creating a customer account. And every time I need to create a customer account, I will use it. So rather than having, let's say, a set of 10 tasks copy-pasted here and there and there, I will put it into a sub-process. If you have coded, you will know this is a principle of refactoring. If you have a piece of code, 10, 15, 20 lines of code, and you see it in three different places, you say, well, maybe I should extract it into a method and call it instead of copy-pasting, because if I copy-paste and later I change it on one side, maybe I forget to change it on the other side, and then I get some inconsistencies, for example, in the way I create customer accounts, which sounds like not a very good idea. And thirdly, you might use it in order to delimit that there is part of a process that needs to be repeated, or that might need to be canceled if something occurs. I'll get back to that later. Let me go first to the first usage of it, decomposing a process. So in essence, when you have a very large process, you have to start thinking like systematically, think about your process as having phases. And then when you identify there is a clear phase in the sub-process, like in this case, receiving and validating a purchase order, think about it, decomposing it into sub-processes. And again, if you are in that sub-process and you find that there is another chunk of the process which can be like a phase, then you will decompose it again into sub-process. In this case, it's about checking the credit of the customer. This is actually a sample of a real process model in the field of supply chain management. It's called SCORE, Supply Chain Operations Reference Models. So people who are doing business process management in supply chain and logistic organizations, this is pretty much their Bible, pretty much. So it's a collection of quite a lot of process models describing how to handle order-to-cash processes, mainly in the field where you have a company with certain suppliers. These suppliers themselves have their own suppliers, and the company has a customer, right? And you want to manage the flows of materials across this entire supply chain. And actually, here you are seeing the third level of decomposition. So the first level is a bunch of processes. The second level are specific processes. And the third level looks like this. And this is the fourth level of subprocess. And this is the fifth level of subprocesses. And very interestingly, only in the fifth level of subprocess do you actually start to get the details. So the point here is that only put details such as gateways in the lower side of your process. Try to keep the upper parts of the processes as clean as possible, and your details put in the lower process. I'm not saying, though, that you should decompose a simple process that fits in 3 pages into 5 levels. That will be completely crazy, right? Every process has its complexity. And you have to find that the composition that fits that complexity. So if the process is moderately complex, 2 levels might be enough. If the process is kind of complex, 3 levels might be enough. If it's a process like SCORE, which is like very large process, then you might need 5, 6 levels of decomposition. Okay? So, and hint, most likely in this course, 2 levels will be enough. Rarely 3. Right. And second hint, this is a modeling guideline, in fact. Every time you have a process that is like mildly complex means like more than 8 or 10 activities, right? More than an exercise that you do in 5 minutes, right? Then the first thing you should do is to map what we call the value chain. And the value chain looks as follows. It's your top level process. It's the first thing you think about. And it is completely linear. Like this. No gateways, no fancy things, no data objects for the time being, just like that. 3, 4, 5 activities. Okay? And the way you discover this process, the theory behind it is that any process is a machine that adds value over time, right? So here you get your raw material, and here you get your value, which I'm going to call added value product. Value added product, sorry. Just don't call this way your events. I'm just saying this is what it is in the theory. And the theory is that you can take any process and think about it as having phases, which will be the activities in the value chain, that add value to your input incrementally. Right? So let me say my raw material are purchase orders. And let me say that my added value product is cash plus satisfied customers. How does it sound? Right? So I need to transform one of those into one of those. I'm going to make it 4. How do I know it is 4? How do you put a giraffe in a refrigerator in 4 steps? Right. It's the same. Okay. So I get a purchase order at random, like that. Poof, somebody knocked me out. I arrived at work at 8 o'clock in the morning and somebody threw a purchase order at me. Right. Oh my God. Right. That was a hard way of getting waked up. And I need to move this purchase order into a cash and satisfied customer. What is the first phase in doing that?
Validating.
Yeah. Having a look at it, right? In a way of saying validating. So I want to have here a validated view. So I will put here like validated view. So that means I need to open it, I need to check if the products are in stock. If they are not in stock, I need to check if I can get them on stock, or I need to order them. If not, I need to check if if the prices that the customer puts in his purchase order coincide with the quotes that I have previously given to the customer or to my price list, depending on whether I work on a basis of advertised price list or on the basis of quotes, which may depend on which products I'm talking about. I need to check if the payment terms from the customer that he wrote into the purchase order, agree with the payment terms we have previously agreed with the customer in previous contracts that we have with that customer, and so on. I might need to enter that purchase order into some system if it doesn't get automatically entered during the submission, etc. Here I have validated POs. What I'm saying is that a validated PO is worth more than a raw PO. And we are going to write a raw PO here. Ten stuff here, 10 POs here is worth more than 10 here. Right? Ten of you having completed this course and passed the exam with an A is worth more than 10 of you now. From the perspective of the process I am running, right? We agree on it. Actually, for you too, you agree, right? You having gotten rid of me is more value added than you still having to get rid of me, right? So, yes, 10 here is worth more than 10 here, both in terms of the fact that we have done work, but also in terms of the fact that sometimes I might get 10 here, I might knock out 2 here, and then I end up with 8 here. I might have my conversion rate might not be 100% in my value chain. What is the next thing we do? Unless I sell digital goods, where I just give you a URL and here's your product. Everything else I have to do some manufacturing. Manufacturing is used specifically in the context of very physical products. I can make it a little bit more generic and say like, produce and pack, right? Ten POs here is worth more than 10 POs there, regardless of what industry I am in. In a manufacturing industry, definitely. 10 POs produced, packed, ready to be shipped, versus 10 pieces of papers that have been validated, well, you know what is worth more. Right? What happens next? Yeah, deliver. And here I have 10 POs that have been delivered. Done. I'm happy. Customer is happy. Yeah, that's worth more than 10 products that are ready to be shipped, but I haven't shipped them. And? Sorry?
Yeah.
More elegant way of saying it. Invoice in the sense of the verb, right? Invoice, like, to invoice as a verb. And payment, and collect payment. Yeah, collect payment is fine as well. Okay? 10 products that have been invoiced and the payment has been collected is worth more than 10 things I have delivered, but I don't have the money, right? You know how it works, right? Better 1 euro now than 2 euros maybe tomorrow, right? So I have kind of identified in this process phases where there is clear added value from one phase to the next one. By identifying what is the raw material and seeing how this raw material incrementally gets converted into my expected output. Okay, so what this is a theory, a business theory. There's a theory called value chain in business, right? That you can take any activity, any process, and you can decompose it this way, and it will work. And it will be useful. Yes?
Isn't it... I guess more clear if you separate, for example, you have different pool lanes, customer or cloud providers in the case of the homework, and then the officers. But can you, is it wise to include in a sub process in the first level, like different entities of a process? For example, like, don't you want to separate a customer from a company in the first level?
Oh, actually, you are right. I did it before. My first step, which I put in process identification, not in process discovery, is to identify who are the actors. And there is one customer that I have to have that very clear, and then the process is performed in one organization primarily. Mm. The organization I am modeling the process for. So there is here implicitly a pool, which is my company. And this should be clear even before I start discovering this process.
Okay.
Yeah, so there is an implicit step because I skipped one of the phases in the BPM lifecycle called process identification. Where you will do that, you will decompose your company into processes, and for every process you will make it clear who is the customer, what are the performance measures of that process, and who, which organizational unit is responsible for that process. Yeah. So that is actually done. So what I will do now, this is a bit of a far shot, but it works. I will make this a sub-process, I will make this a sub-process, this a sub-process, and this a sub-process. And then I will start expanding it. And this is how I'm going to model it. And the theory goes that if you do it this way, life is going to be less painful as a process modeler than if you do not do it this way. That's just theory. That comes from practice. No professional process model nowadays will not do these things. Will be systematic. And then you get something like this. So, one special note. Do you remember this modeling guideline? Activity should be verb followed by noun. Only one exception to that rule is allowed that I know about, and that is precisely when you are naming the activities in evaluation. In that case, you can use the nominal form and talk about, for example, approval, which is not verb followed by noun, or purchase request, goods received, invoice verification, you know, that. You can turn around and essentially nominalize the verb and turn it around. And then this is a process order to cash, and each of these ones you will decompose into an entire process. And given the complexity of this process, it is found that two levels is enough, meaning that I start putting gateways in here. But in more, let's say, real life process modeling, the second level will still not be too detailed. What process modelers will tell you is like, you should have first, let me see if I have that theory there. No, I don't have it. But the theory goes like, first, sequence. Second level, main decision points, only XOR gateways. And only when they correspond to important business decisions. Like, I'm going to kick the customer or I'm not going to kick it. That sounds like an important decision. Third, and then in here you have sub-processes, and only in the third level you introduce lanes, pools and lanes, and all sorts of other gateways in the third level or even in the fourth level.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can separate in one sub-process communication between different lines as well, right?
Yeah. Think about it. This is really one process. I will not put pools here. I will not put lanes here. Because the pools and the lanes especially that I will put will be different here and here and here and here. Each of them gets decomposed into a separate process, which means that process can have its own pools, its own lanes, its own message flows. that are completely different from those that are using here. Because the people who are involved in validating the PO are completely different people than the ones that are involved in producing and paying for that and backing the PO. Yes.
In a company, in one company where this whole order to cash process is done,
yeah.
How do you differentiate between the different pools? Pools, you say, because taking into consideration that the whole big pool is like the company.
Yeah. Let me say, when I validate the PO, for sure, there is a main pool, which is my company,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That one will be in here and here and here and here.
Okay, just to confirm.
Right. Now. In validate PO, I might have a customer involved. In produce a pack, I might not have a customer involved. Not that the customer is not there, it's still there, but I don't need to interact with the customer in this part of the process. Right? In here, I might not have a supplier because I already have produced my products. So I don't have to put supplier pools.
Okay.
Right? And so on. There are two schools. One school is in the second level. They call it second level, use the second level to show the handovers, they call it. And in another school, it's even the third level. So there are kind of two schools of modeling. One will say like handovers in second level and main decisions in third level, details in the fourth level. And the second school will say main decisions in the second level, pools and lanes only in the third level, or fourth level. But that's for processes of a realistic size. Of course, for the process you might be dealing with, two levels is enough. So all this discussion as to whether the pools should come in level two or in level, the lanes should come in level two or in level three is completely academic for you, right? Because anyway, you'll be dealing with only two levels. So that was one use of sub-processes, to decompose your process into a value chain at the top level and then to treat each of these value chains, model each of these value chains separately as completely different processes with different lanes, with different pools, with different message flows, with completely different tasks. The second use of it is when you have a duplication. To prevent duplication. Like, for example, I have two processes. One has to do with home loans. Another has to do with student loans. Handling application for home loans, handling application for student loans, they are really very different processes. They could not be more different. But, nonetheless, they share things. Like, for example, when you have to sign a loan, there are certain checks that are done and then a certain procedure. And let me assume, it might not be true, let me assume they are the same. In that case, I will put a sub-process signed loan and model it only once. Yes?
Can we have a sub-process with parameters?
Like no, at this level, no. At this level, but we can have a data object being given as input to a loan, to a sub-process, because it's an activity. So I can have, let's say, an object called loan contract and have an association between this data object loan contract and this task. That's perfectly possible. And in a way, that is input, you are saying that the loan contract is input to the process signing a loan. Yeah. That's as far as you get in terms of business level modeling, which is what we are currently covering. Now we're going to have like in week 7, or week 8, a completely different discussion as to executable process modeling. And in executable process modeling, yes, every task is going to have input parameters and output parameters. In particular, sub-process activities is called this one. This is a sub-process activity. In particular, sub-process activities are going to have inputs and outputs. And then there's going to get more complicated because we're going to have inbound mappings and outbound mappings. So when you invoke a process, you have to give him the input parameters, and when it returns, you have to map the output parameters to the variables of your process. So, patience. Now, sub-processes can also be used in a third way in BPMN, is if you have repetition in your process or interruption. Repetition or interruption. And you can, what you can do is, like, if you have some repetition, you can refactor it as a sub-process. Like, for example, here, I have this part of the process, single entry, single exit, that has to be executed multiple times, so I will put it into a sub-process, and I will repeat it multiple times. So I will put this marker called a repetition marker. By the way, this marker, repetition marker, I can put it in any activity, not only a sub-process activity, but also I could say that this is repeated if I want. This is only a task, this is not a sub-process. So this process like that with this loop is equivalent to this one. And in this example, it's not very useful, I agree. But when the body of the loop is like 10 activities, then it's kind of very useful. Because rather than seeing an arrow going from here to there, I will abstract the sub-process, the thing that is repeated in a separate process, and I will indicate using a marker that that sub-process can be repeated multiple times. These markers is called sequential repetition, and is an equivalent of a repeat loop, meaning that you will repeat this task until a given condition is satisfied. And this is a business level model, so I am not required to specify the exit condition, but it is good practice to specify by means of this type of textual annotations. This is a textual annotation in BPMN. And I will write in there that I will repeat this until the response is approved. This is plain English, right? The same as when you write something in the flow that comes out of an XOR script, that's plain English, that you use to describe when do you take one branch or the other branch, like I did here. Okay, your turn. Because I saw someone was sleeping. The best way to model is to move. Movement is the best moment of modeling. Very well known. When you do detailed thinking, like you are programming, you want to be like this. But when you are doing higher level thinking, like modeling, you want to be like this. Believe me, it works.
So it says after a Clemens register, it is examined by a Clemens officer. So that's a task, right? Okay.
Another activity is a check.
No, but that's a decision.
It's like a condition. This is like a check to clean, and then it has like a gateway. If it clean, okay, then you go to another activity.
So you want a gateway? It's a
code.
So,
do we need a gateway? Gateway doesn't really work. It's not active.
Okay.
Yeah, just like this is a common issue. It's not possible to get a lot of user. It's like condition. It's available as like a gateway.
So, we need parallel.
It's not necessary to put them in.
Okay. And then so send back the claims officer. We got an activity. Or just
just like some of the
There is task and there is the output of the task, right? So the sentence is there to confuse you a little bit because the task and the output of the task are a little bit mixed.
Do you want this in the back?
So what is the task itself? Exactly, right? And you are tempted to put the writing, the recommendation, as a separate task, right?
Mm-hmm.
What are the pros and the cons of putting this different task? So here is a checklist for you. I'll put them as different tasks if they are performed by different people. Is it the case? No. Or it makes sense to first do one, then wait 3 days, and then do the second one. No. Or sometimes you do one but not the other. Just examine it.
Could it just associate the data object?
Yes, exactly. So I feel that examining the claim and writing a recommendation is actually the same.
Yeah.
What happens is that writing the recommendation is the final part of examining the claim, and it leads to the production of a data object. Called the settlement recommendation. Okay, check and capture that way. Then what happens? Wow, that was very quick. This guy wrote a settlement recommendation and then he stopped there. then I don't have a robot that looks at it and says, okay, well, okay. Someone has to check it. Yeah. Right? This is the senior guy. And then, now that it has been checked, now it's okay. Which way is okay? This way is okay. And if it's okay, I have notified the customer. And I'm pretty much done. And if it's not okay, right. Now, just for fun, how can I replace this backward edge with a sub process?
This
put this loop, where does the loop start? Like here. I'll take these. I'll even take these. I'll put in a sub process, right? Copy paste. And I now only need to find a way to name that sub process. It could be actually simply, you know, examine claim or assess claim. And then it gets the details, and I'll make it a sub process, and I'll put a sequential repetition mark, and I'll put an annotation to say, until OK or until settlement is accepted. And a lot of things can happen there, by the way. This process, I can, yes?
It's a claim, you know, on the market as well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I guess that if you wanted to start showing artifacts, you will, a prime candidate for an artifact would be the claim. And it will be given an input assessing. Yeah, you can actually say that this creates a claim. I actually, I'm not quite sure that claim register, we did the process that finished with claim register last week, and it was not such that it created the claim. It was the task preceding it that updated the claim or something like that, so that would not be correct. But on the other hand, here I can write that this produces a settlement recommendation. That not surprisingly, this produces. Right. Okay, this was very simple, but I mean, you can think about assessing the claim in reality as being a more complex sort of process.
So when it has write something, it's like a data object, it's not a activity or something.
This means, in a way, to update or to write. So this sub-process writes in a settlement recommendation. And this means to read, in a way, or to use, or to consume. So the assess, to assess the claim, I need to read the claim.
I mean, when write a settlement recommendation, is it like an activity or just?
That is somewhere here inside. This is a step inside. We mentioned just before that it could be combined with the activity examine claim. And here is a quick checklist to know when you have a doubt to separate two tasks, put them one next to the other, or to put them a single one, is like, are they performed by different people? If yes, then separate them, right? Is it such that sometimes you will do one but not the other? Like you do one and maybe you do the other, maybe not. If yes, then separate them. Otherwise, leave them together. And the third question will be, is it the case that sometimes you do one, you wait 3 days and you do the second one? Right? If yes, then maybe it makes sense to separate. Otherwise, it's together. So the task, the granularity of a task becomes such that it's a unit of work, performed by a person, possibly in a single go. Yeah? And it's atomic. You either perform it or you do not, but it's not like you perform a little bit and then maybe not the other bit, etc. There has to be some notion of atomicity. Yes.
So, notify customer means like we already complete all acceptance, all checking, and so on. But why do you have a cessation with settlement recommendation with customer? I mean, if it's relates only for excess claim, the settlement. No, this actually means notify the settlement to the customer. So in case of errors, or no, so that the customer knows about it.
So you give a phone call to a customer, you start explaining them. You remember the claim you lodged like 1 month ago? Yeah. How has it been doing in the meantime? You know, how is your lab doing? Yeah, it's doing fine. Yeah.
So it's just
sorry, we rejected your claim. Yeah, that's pretty much what goes on.
I guess. And so, what's the there is a settlement recommendation note there?
Yeah.
Why is connected to the notified customer activity as well? Because that seems to be like an internal activity.
No, no, no. This is an artifact. Here means.
Yeah, something. But why is it? I mean, that arrow going to the notified customer, but
I'm just saying that when I go and notify the customer, I read the settlement recommendation. I take it.
Okay.
I read it and I call the customer. I say, right. Sorry, we rejected your claim.
Okay.
Yeah, I use it.
Yeah.
And it's completely optional. And I will not abuse of it, and I will only perhaps do it when it brings some information, right? It's,
okay.
It's not obvious otherwise, right? Which means that in this example, I might very well not do it.
So you're saying it's not necessary to model the data object?
Yeah. Then it becomes this. I mean, a process model, you are trying to convey information. If you're writing something, don't write in something that is too obvious. So try to write the things that someone might not get the point that you need the settlement recommendation to notify the customer. Right.
But I'm asking, like, for normal, like, a business process modeling, it's recommended to have it?
It depends on the purpose. If I am doing a process model because I am going to start an IT project to automate that process, this is definitely very useful.
Sure.
Because here is where I'm going to know which data objects I use in the project and where do I need to use them, right? Or when I'm going to use it to maintain an existing system too, because then I know if I affect another data object, which activities are going to be affected. So if I'm doing process modeling for the purpose of an implementation project, definitely very useful. Now, if I am doing process model because I think this process is performing pretty poorly, but I do not know what to change yet and why it performs poorly, then that actually might be noise, right? Maybe more important there will be to first capture the activities and to see, for example, which activities are redundant, are like unnecessary. First, I try to get rid of unnecessary activities. And then only if I find that, well, it's not very clear which activities are redundant, maybe I will look for further details, right? So, which makes it a little bit nasty because you might need to model the processes many times for different purposes. Usually not the same person, by the way. It's different persons in the organization. And then, which creates a bit of a problem because you want to keep all these different versions kind of together and That's an art, right? It's called business process architecture. Okay, sometimes you repeat, but you don't repeat sequentially, like you did here. But you do the same thing multiple times in parallel. For example, there are companies where if a purchase is above a certain amount, say above 5,000 euros, you have to get at least 3 quotes from different suppliers. In the case of a non-trivial product, that means you have to engage in 3 interactions with 3 different suppliers. You have to send them an initial specification, they might ask you questions, you might need to reply to their questions, might ask you another round of questions. Once they are satisfied, they will give you a quote. You might actually ask them questions on their quote. They might reply you to your quote, and so on, until you're satisfied of the quote. And you think, okay, this is the offer that matches, their best offer that matches my product. And you need to do that for three different suppliers, or for four different suppliers. Right? Or when you receive a purchase order, purchase orders are decomposed usually into line items, right? You know very well this thing. Yeah? So different line items. One line item for different products. For every product in the purchase order, you need to go through a process of validating it. You need to check if that product exists in the catalog, maybe it exists, but with a different code than what was written in the line item. You need to resolve it. You might need to call the customer to ask them, what did you mean by this line item? And you need to check the stock availability. If it's not there, you might need to order them. You might need to check if you are able to deliver by the date, etc. So there is a whole validation process that needs to happen for every line item separately. There might be 10 line items or maybe 15 line items. And you need to repeat the validation for each of these line items. Now, it doesn't make sense to first take the first line item, do all the validation, and 3 days later say, oh, now let's look at the second one, right? And then do all the validation and then say, oh, now let's look at the third one, right? Because there are all sorts of waiting times in the middle. So you want to do them in parallel. So it's like you want to repeat the same thing multiple times, but all these times are occurring in parallel. So there is this is a very frequent thing in business processes. It happens quite frequently. And that's why in BPMN there is a special marker for it. So if there is part of a process that gets repeated multiple times in parallel, you first isolate it and you put it as a sub-process. In this case, obtaining a quote is a sub-process. And then you put these parallel repetition markers, two times, two bars. And that means that you're going to obtain the quote multiple times in parallel. And then you put an annotation to say, how do you determine how the repetition is done, or how many times repeated. In this case, is for each supplier, you will obtain the quote. So you take a product, you see which suppliers provide that product, and for each of these suppliers, you will repeat this process. And when you go into executable mode, there is some additional information that you have to attach to this activity to say, for example, will I wait for every single supplier to give me a quote, or is it enough if I have two quotes, etc., right? And that's called a completion condition, and once the completion condition happens, then you can proceed. So by default, this type of activity means that you're going to execute the same sub-process multiple times for, let's say, different suppliers, and only once you have completed with all of them, you will continue with the next activity, which in this case is to select the best quote. But you can also add some additional parameters to say when exactly would you stop. Okay, so that was pretty much what I wanted to say about sub-processes and how can you use sub-processes in BPMN. Any questions about that? Everything is fine.
Can we... question?
Yes.
Should we implement also some kind of common sense for the inspection job?
Common sense too?
For homework, which we did in the first.
Yes.
I mean,
and
can we use this sub-process also now?
This is a guideline, right? If you don't follow this guideline, I will shoot you. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Right. You will make my life easy if you don't follow the guide. Yes, I just need to remove you the points and forget about it.
Even with such trivial case like this.
No, you still have to use common sense. But I mean that. But this guideline says, take your process and decompose it into a value chain, and then each of these processes you can, you know, decompose it further. That's what the guideline says. Yes. Yeah, actually, from the homework perspective, that guideline was the main point. So all this blah, 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 I did just summarize it like, if you only care about the homework, just summarize it like, whatever. What he said is that in my homework, I needed to put a value chain with multiple sub-processes, and then I have to model each sub-process separately. Right. Got the point. You can walk away. Bye-bye. Great.
So what are we giving you? The value chain or the whole thing?
The whole thing, of course. Yeah. If I only see the value chain, I will assume that that's all you did. I mean, you might have spent 10 hours doing the rest, but I will not see it. What a shame. Then I will say, wow, that's all you did. Right, 3 activities in a row. God, you need just me. I mean, how much time did it take you? Yeah. And if you only give me all the enchiladas and not the value chain, I might think, well, I mean, he did all these enchiladas, but he didn't think about doing the value chain, right? What a shame.
So
you want both of them? Yeah. I mean, in any process modeling tool, by the way, these things get packed in the same file. So if you use Visage, for example, the top level process and the sub process get packed in the same .bpm file. If you use Signavio, the top level process and the sub process get packed in the same space. Right. So yeah.
Question.
Yes.
Sometimes. Sub-processes and passing messages through pools is kind of similar. Is there a rule for using each pool?
One thing I think you should only use message flows. In real life, there are exceptions to the rule I'm going to give you. But in this course's life, there might not be any exceptions to the rule. You have a main pool, and you will model a process in here. And this process will send messages to a sub-process, to another pool. Nothing here. In this other pool, don't put anything. Nothing. Yet. Not a single activity. Not a single event, not a single gateway, not a single AND gateway, nothing, yet, only here. Right? Apparently some people do not agree with me. And they are right, because if you are modeling what we call a collaborative process, which is like in supply chain where you're modeling the details collaboration between two partners, you might actually want to put things in the other pool. But in this course, most likely, it will be enough if you only model this one. Right? Model one right, rather than many wrong. This is your pool, this is mine, I model this. I can mention that I'm sending a message to this other guy, but I'm not going to start saying what this other guy should do with that message. So I'm going to draw my message flows from my pool to the boundary of the other pool, and I'm not going to detail what's happening there.
Does this also apply for the Hangul?
I think for the whole course you can apply it. Right. Okay. I kind of didn't manage to cover some parts of BPMN, so I'll leave them for next week, where Fabrizio is going to then cover the remaining parts. Yes.
For the homework, I assume it's okay if we have this observer's other guy who's observing with us, it's not doing the slave part, and then we have this activity and we delegate our task to him, and then we get some message back.
Well, you don't delegate things to a customer. Here's where I put the customer. But you might want to delegate. Produce, manufacture the product, or deliver the product, you might want to delegate it to a logistics company. And then yes, if that applies in your case, this is fine. The message, manufacture product, is sent, and this logistics company is going to take care of the details. Or check the insurance policy is delegated to the insurance provider. Why not? Or I ask a hospital, send me a report, and the hospital sends it to me. That's fine. I don't need to model the details of how the hospital produces the report.
But we can show the message that you send.
Yeah. Request report. Well, here's the report. These are a report request, and the other one is the actual report. Yeah, you can do that, why not? But I don't need to model what's going on in the hospital. Right. Don't overdo it. Don't overdo it. Just give me 2 minutes so that I tell you that this is going to be useful in your homework. That in BPMN, first we have seen you have start events and end events. Start events and end events differ because end events are bold, start events are not bold. You can have in the middle of a process an event. For example, if you are waiting for a message in the middle of a process, you can have it there, no problem. So the events are not only start and end events, there can be events in the middle. Every event, no, most events, not every event, but most events will have a trigger. And there are two triggers that are going to be important for us. One of them is a message occurs because we received a message. Then I will put an envelope inside. So I can have a message received at the start of the process or a message received in the middle. Or a process might end by me sending a message, in which case I will put an envelope also in the end event to say that as a result of me doing this process, I'm sending a message somewhere. And the second type of trigger is going to be the timer events. And these timer events, which is a clock, can be attached to a start event. You can say something like, every Monday at 7 p.m. I'll start the backup process, for example. Or every Monday at 7 a.m. I'll check if any reports have been received from the hospital. Or every 3 months I'm not going to continue because otherwise I'll give you the answer to part of your homework. Or in the middle of a process, I need to say, occasionally, you have to say, I need to wait 2 business days for something. So I wait 2 business days, then I check if I received the report. So I say, here I can write 2 days, and it means I'm waiting for 2 days. Now, if you are waiting for a message, don't wait for 2 days. Wait for the message. But occasionally, you might want to wait for 2 days. Like, for example, here, I register a PO, and then if it's a weekend or a holiday, I wait until the next working day, and then I move on and execute the rest of the process. So in the middle of a process, I'm waiting, literally sitting down and waiting for some time. So here is where you can use an intermediate timer event. And here is an example of where you use a message event. You know, you receive a purchase order, and if there is a, you receive a, you wait for a PO change request. If you receive a PO change request, you register, and then maybe you receive another one, right? This is a fictitious example. And then there are other types of events. These ones are useful if you want to partition your process into multiple sub-diagrams, you know, but this is not necessarily going to happen to you. It's really when you get into very, very large processes. And this is what you will see next week.